Добрый день, дорогие коллеги, добрый день, уважаемые хозяева этого здания. Я хочу вам сказать, что я очень рада всех вас здесь видеть, во-первых. И во-вторых, я хочу поблагодарить школу за то, что они подготовили такое очень хорошее мероприятие. Я в таком большом предвкушении. Что я хочу сказать? Значит, сегодня у нас в аудитории в основном сидят молодые специалисты по просьбе департамента образования. Вот. И мы хотели бы, чтобы вы сами через себя пропустили вот эту работу, чтобы вам потом было удобнее использовать ее в своей работе в школе. И еще мы пригласили несколько преподавателей, уже имеющих определенный стаж. Во-первых, это Гаухар Исмагомбетовна, она у нас возглавляет, одна из трех преподавателей, возглавляющих школу молодого учителя. Теперь должна была подойти Светлана Федоровна с 29-й школы и Татьяна Валерьевна Машинец, но вместо нее пришла Евгения Хамбетовна. Вот они у нас как бы три руководителя школы молодого специалиста. Кроме того, несколько человек уже имеют определенный стаж работы. А в основном это у нас масса, основная масса, которая имеет всего 2 месяца стажа, 9 месяцев стажа, 1 год, максимум 2 года стажа. И, конечно, вы сейчас на самом начале своей педагогической деятельности. И нам хочется, чтобы вы посмотрели работу на таком высоком уровне и ставили себе планку высокую, чтобы вы тоже достигли того уровня. И я хочу сказать, что сейчас на дворе 21 век, и, конечно, если мы будем учить своих детей старыми методами, как говорится, тупо заучивать слова, читать, писать и на этом остановиться, то никаких результатов не будет. Поэтому сейчас существует много различных инновационных современных технологий, одной из которых является проектная деятельность. Я должна сказать, что в школе Мирас в этой технологии достигнуты большие успехи. И они хотят вот своим опытом поделиться с вами. Особенность этой технологии, я долго не буду останавливаться, в том, что она дает возможность для творческой деятельности не только учителя, но и учащихся. Иной раз начинают в одном направлении идти, и вдруг, знаете, вот появляются новые идеи, фантазии, и дети осуществляют. И через вот эту деятельность, все это пропуская через себя, они лучше усваивают язык. И не только язык, они учатся мыслить, они учатся ставить свои цели и достигать их. Вот в этом особенность проектной технологии. И поэтому я думаю, сегодня мы с вами творчески поработаем. Я не буду отнимать у вас много времени. Все это расскажет сегодняшняя хозяева нашей школы Мирас. А я вам желаю good luck.
Уважаемые коллеги, мы очень рады в очередной раз встретить гостей в стенах нашей школы. Наша школа существует уже 10-й год, мы работаем 10-й год, развивая новые инновационные программы и уже наработан определенный опыт, и, конечно, мы сейчас и рады, и готовы поделиться с вами этим опытом. Перед началом работы, вашей работы в рамках поставленной темы, я хотела буквально несколько слов сказать вам о нашей школе, чтобы было понятно о том, в каком мы направлении двигаемся и почему мы работаем именно так, а не иначе. Вообще наша школа является филиалом фонда образования Нурсултана Назарбаева. И эта школа была организована в 1999 году. А в декабре, за полгода до этого, был открыт фонд образования Нурсултана Назарбаева. И вот сейчас, в декабре, мы уже будем праздновать десятилетие фонда. И очень многие мероприятия, которые мы проводим именно в рамках празднования вот этого нашего первого юбилея. За эти 10 лет пройден очень большой путь учителями нашей школы. Дело в том, что наша школа является экспериментальной площадкой Министерства образования. И главная наша задача – это формирование в Казахстане инновационной модели казахстанской международной школы. То есть такой школы, в которой дети получали бы образование, соответствующее международным стандартам. Такой школы, в которой дети могли бы получать сертификаты международного образца, не покидая пределов республики, и имея этот сертификат, получать образование за рубежом. Право такого образования или право на такое образование, оно далось нам нелегко, потому что нужно было пройти несколько этапов очень серьезных экзаменов. Экзаменов по авторизации по международным программам, экзамен по аккредитации международными образовательными организациями. И уже в 2004 году, то есть через 5 лет, мы получили право на реализацию программы основной школы международного бакалавриата. И в этом же году мы получили аккредитацию трех международных организаций образовательных, НИАСК, CIS и CIS. Это организации, которые объединяют международные школы, соответствующие довольно строгим международным стандартам. И для того, чтобы получить вот эти права, мы встречали команды авторизационные, аккредитационные команды, которые проверяли вот абсолютно все этапы, все составляющие нашей школы, нашей школьной жизни, нашей школьной образовательной модели на соответствие высоким образовательным стандартам. Через 2 года мы получили еще и авторизацию по программе начальной школы международного бакалавриата. И прошли уже в прошлом году процесс evaluation по программе основной школы международного бакалавриата. Что это значит? Мы не просто получаем право на реализацию этих программ. Через каждый определенный промежуток времени к нам опять приезжает команда из организации международного бакалавриата, и мы еще раз должны доказывать, что мы идем, что мы выполняем вот эти требования, что мы идем, мы реализуем те программы, те требования, которые вот в этой программе были заложены. Наша образовательная программа — это не просто программа, которая реализует вот эти международные программы. Мы как школа экспериментальная формируем, создаем интегрированную образовательную модель. То есть наша образовательная модель интегрирует и рекомендации организации международного бакалавриата, то есть мы внедряем основные положения, мы внедряем эту международную программу, и плюс наши исследуем нашим казахстанским стандартам. И не случайно выбор пал именно на программу международного бакалавриата, потому что эти программы позволяют нам на наших национальных программах реализовывать наши национальные программы посредством вот огромного арсенала средств, которые нам дает программа международного бакалавриата, и не только реализовывать. Программа международного бакалавриата дополняет нашу образовательную модель, дополняет образовательную модель казахстанскую новыми средствами, новыми формами, методами работы. И мы делаем акцент на формирование навыков, на умений ученика. Вот то, что сейчас лежит, является, на что сейчас делается акцент в наших новых образовательных стандартах, в проекте новых образовательных стандартов для 12-летней школы. Как это сделать? Каким образом это делать? Вот об этом сегодня будут говорить наши учителя английского языка. Вообще я хочу сказать, что как международная школа, в нашей школе очень большое внимание уделяется развитию языков и развитию культур. Но, наверное, это два понятия неразрывно связаны, да, между собой. И с этой целью у нас разработана так называемая языковая политика. В соответствии с этой политикой мы ставим перед собой задачу создания полилингвальной образовательной среды. Среды, в которой получили бы развитие, во-первых, 3 языка – казахский, английский, русский язык. И плюс к этому мы стараемся уделить внимание развитию родного языка каждого ребенка, потому что школа у нас международная, и дети у нас со многих стран мира. Вот вы видели, сколько у нас в атриуме флагов. И преподаватели у нас тоже со многих стран мира. И наша задача — поддержать язык, родной язык каждого ребенка, развить культуру каждого ребенка. И больший акцент, приоритет в нашем международном сообществе школьном отдается именно английскому языку, как языку общения. Поэтому задача, которая стоит перед нашей кафедрой, кафедрой английского языка, это не просто научить детей там, в основном грамматики, разговорной речи и так далее, а создать вот эту языковую среду общения. Мы все учимся, у нас учатся дети, обучаются учителя, мы все развиваем навыки говорения вот на всех 3 языках. И это здорово, потому что это то, что сближает людей, это то, что сближает нашу культуру. Я не буду много говорить, дальше еще говорить можно о многом, но перед началом вашей работы я хочу представить сегодня нашу кафедру, представить людей, которые будут вести сегодняшний семинар. Вообще я хочу сказать, что у нас кафедра английского языка – это особая кафедра, там особая атмосфера. Это настолько, я считаю, что это гордость и ценность нашей школы, потому что настолько развито творчество у этих людей, вы сегодня это увидите, настолько они дружны, настолько они готовы поделиться опытом друг с другом, и сегодня они поделятся опытом с вами. И результаты работы, конечно, очень ощутимые, мы их ощущаем, мы их очень ценим. Ну, наверное, первый, кого я хочу представить, это руководитель кафедры Людмила Анатольевна Шкарлатова. Вот, кстати, по проблемам, о которых сегодня будет говорить, которые сегодня будут подниматься на семинаре, критериальному оцениванию. Буквально в последнем номере журнала «Being Vision Blue Star» вышла статья Людмила Анатольевна по критериальному оцениванию. Поэтому, если вас эта проблема заинтересует, найдите этот журнал, он найдет статью. Я думаю, что какие-то идеи вы сможете использовать в своей работе. Кузнецов Анатолий Владимирович. Анатолий Владимирович у нас является, ну, тут много сейчас я могу перечислить. Учитель английского языка – это раз, причем очень высококвалифицированный, грамотный учитель. Во-вторых, Анатолий Владимирович у нас является, ну, на английском языке «Dean of Student», мы это переводим как заместитель директора по работе со студентами. Это очень большой объем работы. Во-вторых, Анатолий Владимирович является у нас ко-координатором по внедрению программы международного бакалавриата в основной школе. Ну и, наверное, еще о чем мне очень хочется сказать, что Анатолий Владимирович является тренером организации международного бакалавриата по внедрению программы. Он является членом и авторизационных команд, и команд, которые проводят процесс оценивания evaluation process в школах. И поэтому имеет достаточно большой опыт в этом направлении работы. И еще мне очень хочется представить двух преподавателей, еще этой кафедры преподавателей очень творческих, очень высокой квалификации, очень грамотных преподавателей. Это Елизавета Чем и Адема Манжуловна. Эти преподаватели у нас работают, ну, наверное, не так долго, да, но столько опыта, столько творчества, но я не знаю, мне вот мое ощущение, что они работают с самого основания школы, потому что настолько вот во всем этом разбирается, столько новых идей, настолько люди действительно грамотные и творчески работающие. Все, больше я вам ничего говорить не буду, все остальное скажет вам вот эта команда, замечательная команда наших учителей. Thank you, Camille.
So, today we have mostly a guest, right? Our secondary school principal.
It's okay.
So, Susan, please, the floor to you.
Okay.
I would like to tell you that he just arrived to Kazakhstan, and it is only the second or third day in Astana. The
third
day in Astana. So you see, he has no experience, but he's very happy to stay here.
Absolutely.
Yes.
Welcome to Miras International School. As Lucy said, I arrived on Sunday. So this is all new to me, as I suspect it's possibly new to some of you. And learning a language, I realise, is so important. Last night, I went to April supermarket to do some shopping with no Kazakh or Russian. And the cashier asked me for some money, and all I could do was give her some notes and say, "Spasiba." And she looked at me and said, "Oh, thank you." She looked at me, "No, no, 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 no." And all I could do was shake my head, open my arms and say, "I'm sorry, I don't understand." I've always found languages difficult to learn. When my French teacher in England, many years ago, were having a French lesson, he would make me stand up, recite French, and glare at me very angrily if I got something wrong, and it frightened me. It made me frightened of learning languages. I lost confidence. So I really do think that one of the most important skills of a language teacher, whether it be French, Russian or English, is not only to instill confidence and enthusiasm, but also to create enjoyment and fun. learning a language should be fun. Teaching should be fun, and learning should be fun and enjoyable. So all I would say to you, as a having had something like 27 or 28 years teaching, is always bear that in mind as you go away from this wonderful workshop that's been organised, which will be incredibly useful to you. But always bear in mind that teaching and learning should be enjoyable, and the students should have fun. Thank you very much.
Good morning, dear colleagues. It's a great pleasure to see all of you here. Welcome to Miraz International School again. And after all these flattering words from Galina, you may expect something which is out of this world. Please do not, because we are just ordinary teachers who face lots of problems in organization of the project activity, in collaborating with each other, in inspiring the students with confidence about their language learning, etc. That's why we just consider this as an opportunity which is provided to us by the Department of Education to share our ideas with you and to have your feedback and your participation, which is extremely valuable for us. Well, first of all, judging by the title of our workshop, Issues Addressed in Project Activity Planning and Delivery at Lessons of English, obviously you may have some questions. And this is, by the way, you have this these stickers on your tables and this napkin. So we will use both of these right now. So on the stickers, we encourage you to write a question that appears in your mind as soon as you just hear the title of the topic. So the title of the topic again: Issues Addressed in Project Activity. The very first question that you may have, we will call it burning issue, and hopefully by the end of this workshop, you may find some answers, some responses to the question that you may have. Also, please do not hesitate to stop us at any moment when you are not comfortable in understanding, saying, well, could you please repeat, we don't understand, or whatever. And we will be here just to help you. So any question that appears in your mind pertaining the title of the session.
The questions could be different.
Absolutely.
They don't connect with our workshop or with your work.
Yes, please do.
My question, for example, I would like to go home today by 6, not by 9.
Lucy,
please
do not be in a hurry, okay? Because this should be a question connected to the topic, okay? Any question? Adela will just collect your questions, and as we progress with our workshop, you may just find responses, find answers to these questions. Okay? No. It's not necessary. Of course not. Just a very simple question that you may have, hearing the title of the session. We are speaking about planning, we are speaking about the delivery of projects, so obviously we may have some, you know, stages of these projects, tasks, activities that we get the students involved into, etc. To your questions at the later stage of our workshop.
I can't do only three words. Just a word is a project.
Yes. What activities can we involve in the project, whatever?
anything. Any question about, you know, the topic, which is politics, basically?
We had a statute written.
Oh, you've written?
Yes.
Oh, great. Okay, very good.
Great. Now, the second activity tends to be tends to be less consuming, time-consuming, hopefully, because, well, on this napkin, you will just write down an issue which is within your concern, which concerns you, a problem that you may have, but which is not connected to the topic of the workshop. Well, let me give you my concern. I don't have the time to visit my parents, although they keep on calling me saying, could you please visit us? Anytime you want. So
anytime,
this is my concern.
Anytime thinking about the concert on Friday.
The concert on
I'm
Friday.
I'm so worried about this because
okay.
We are not ready.
Yeah. So I just put it on this napkin, okay? Saying, well, visiting parents.
Okay. Write
visiting parents. This is my concern. Which is not connected to the topic of the workshop because the topic of the workshop is project activities. Right. As soon as you do it, please follow suit. Look at me. What I am doing now. Good. Yes, yes, yes.
I'm sorry.
Well, visiting parents.
Ourselves. I think we should go dress ourselves.
Yes.
No, problem.
Having lunch prepared for my husband.
Yes, something like this.
Okay. Yes, yes, thank you, Lucy. You're right. Right. Absolutely. Thank you very much. Yeah, you've got it. You've got it. Right. So this is what we call burning tissue, because this is something. Well, imagine that it is now set on fire, and you just forget about it for the next couple of hours. Okay. So it is just set on fire. Now, before we start speaking about the specifics of the project activity and the fundamentals that we have in mind when planning, I would like just to brief you about our abbreviations, which are quite familiar to us, but which may be new to you. So we have such abbreviations as IB. IB stands for International Baccalaureate. An International Baccalaureate is an international organization which provides three programs, for primary school, for middle school, and for the secondary school in our traditional classification. There are many schools which follow this curriculum, which follow this framework. One of the schools is ours, Miraz International School. Well, then NYP. NYP stands for Middle Years Program, which is a specific program of the International Baccalaureate designed for students aged 11 to 16. And this program has specifics. One of the specifics is the so-called areas of interaction. Well, in spite of this title, and in spite of something that you may face not understanding, the areas of interaction are quite simple. The idea behind them is that we try to relate the material that we cover during the lessons with real-life practice through specific aspects of our everyday life. Well, some of the titles of the areas of interaction just speak for themselves, like health and social education, for instance. It's clear that if we study a specific topic, let us say sports, this will be dealt through this particular area of interaction. We will focus on such issues as, you know, health issues, how we communicate with each other, how we maintain healthy relations with our community, etc. Well, then community and service. Obviously, the students there, through this area of interaction, are encouraged to see their place in the community they live in, to identify what they can do, what their responsibility can be to address the needs of the community they live in, so that to make the community more prosperous, better, and well off. Then environments, that's another area of interaction, which actually covers such areas as nature around us, or man-made communities, man-made societies, man-made environments such as cities. If we study the topic city, well, the obvious connection to real life will be through this area of interaction. Then, community and service, environments,
human ingenuity,
thank you. Human ingenuity. Well, every time that we study an invention, that we focus on invention, we also speak about the impact of this invention on us as people, on human mind, on the development, focusing both on positive aspects and negative aspects. And this is also how we connect the material with real life issues. So areas of interaction may be considered to be just a focus in our planning, which we'll be speaking a bit later. Now, the fundamental aspect of the program, which is by no means contradictory to our standard, I mean the MYP, this agrees with our standard, but it extends the standard with innovative teaching practices, innovative teaching methodologies, thus providing a very good connection between what we study in one lesson and what we study in other subject areas. The fundamentals of this program and the fundamentals of our planning may be considered to be the so-called IB learner profile. So I'm now leaving you with this promotional film, which may not take long, but which hopefully will provide you with some gist of what the IB learner profile is about. Now, yes, the film, our film. Okay. I've been on the profile is or should be evident through all the activities that we have, both within our curriculum, within the thing that we plan for our lessons, and for extracurricular activities. It should be sort of, you know, a whole school approach to developing. When the students understand, when the students realize that these are the things which will be important for them in their future life after school. Well, now the second part of our today's workshop will be developed will be devoted to the fundamentals of our planning and how we develop this in a more structured piece. By the way, you have your main parts. There are three samples for each table. Main parts they will be just the same as you see on the screen, and all of you individually. We'll also have the so-called support part, which will be very useful for us during this stage of our workshop, support part. Now, in order to be meaningful for the students, as we consider it, learning should be connected to real-life practice. It should exceed the limits of the lesson, the limits of the material that we cover. How do we do it? So there are numerous ways of getting the students involved as active participants of what is happening at the lesson. If we take, for instance, the topic A Good Life, which I just put here.
A Good Life.
And after you study the material that the students will be taught in the lessons. After you examine all the resources, examine all the opportunities for extra school involvement of students, then you will come to your understanding that there should be something in the planning, should be something in the beginning that will inspire the students, that will motivate the students for further exploration of the topic. And this is what we call the concept. You have it on page 3 in the main part, page 3 in the main part. And this is what we are going to use right now. Now, how do we encourage the students to come up with the concept? We may organize a brainstorming activity. Like, at the beginning of the lesson, when we begin covering this topic, I would just go into the classroom, draw this picture, and say, well, please, your associations with A Good Life. So what do we associate with A Good Life? Welcome, welcome, welcome. A Good Life, what is it?
Money, you are happy.
Well, health. For some people. Money, relatives.
Health and health.
Health, thank you, those who said it.
Prosperity.
Family. Excellent, good relations, yes. Good relations. What else?
Job.
Yes. Job. Okay, well, that's enough. Please raise the hands, those of you who disagree with any of this. Everybody does. Well, everybody agrees. And this is what our next stage is. The next stage is what is called the MYP unit question. Well, this is the guiding question that we will always return in our curriculum delivery when we do the tasks, and we inspire the students to see, you know, beyond the tasks themselves. Like, for instance, if we study the text about relatives, then we may ask them to return to the question that we come up with at the beginning, and ask them to provide their ideas of how it is connected to real life issues. Not only to the issues which is described in the text, right? But also to the issues connected to their own experience, to their own families. Well, the question that we propose might be something like, because everybody agrees in the audience. Why are the attributes of a good life, or let us say, some attributes. Some attributes of a good life, universal. Why are these attributes universal? Why do people accept them? Well, this is the guiding question. This is an open-ended question. And this is, by the way, one of the criteria for a good guiding question. The question should also be relevant to the student's experience. It means that it should be connected to their previous knowledge. They should know about...
good life. You
of a good life, yes. Of a good life, thank you. They should know, something about this word attribute. They should know the word universal. Of course they do know this. Well, the question should also be challenging, which means that it should provide them with opportunities to explore something new in this topic. And this means that we need to tailor the tasks so that to extend the students' opportunities here. And the tasks, by the way, the planning itself, is given on page four, in our support, support start, right? Support part. So I'm just going to brief you about the tasks that we have designed, because we use just a simple normal textbook. But we extend the textbook with specific tasks, which, on one hand, will address the linguistic mega skills of oral communication, of listening, of reading, and of writing, and on the other hand, will also provide the students with opportunities to go beyond these linguistic skills. Well, on stage one, for instance. We organized the brainstorming and encouraged the students to design a class poster. So they will identify the three attributes which are of paramount importance for them, and then they design something like a mural or a poster or just a description of why they consider this particular attribute important. Like for instance, relatives. Why is this important for you? Or money, somebody's.
Education,
right? Why is this important? They will just explain it in their picture and in their writing about it. Well, on the second stage, they will have their own personal inquiry about hobbies, different hobbies that people will have. Because what we came up at the beginning was that somebody said hobby is an idea of a good life and is an attribute of a good life. So we decided to explore this a little bit. The third thing here is it turned out that all of them have hobbies, and we also decided to explore it, advising the students to write about their hobbies and to present the hobbies to the rest of the class. On stage four, they made a survey where they asked numbers of the questions are on page five here. So they needed to come up with the questions, and thus we checked their ability in grammar. And they also went beyond the classroom, asking their friends, asking their relatives, asking whoever in the community outside the school, so that to have a clear picture, a holistic picture of what people's responses to different aspects of a good life might be. And on stage five, they came up with the presentation, which, in its turn, will also be very closely connected to such area, such subject as mathematics. They just use their mathematical skills here to design graphs. Within the project, we also encourage the students to work out their flyers. And flyers will be devoted to their favorite types of sport, like basketball, for instance, volleyball or whatever, different types of sports. With this, we pursued two aims. The first aim was to encourage the students to see the connection between English as the subject area and physical education. It's a very natural connection between these two subjects here. And on the other hand, we also provided them with an opportunity to express them, well, to carry out their research inquiry and to express themselves based on this research. Which means that we have also explored such skill as creative writing. Well, as the outcome of the project, after they wrote their reflective essay, we organized sort of a presentation. We devoted two lessons for the presentation. We identified the aspects that the students were expected to cover at the presentation, but we provided the students with an absolutely free hand to choose any form of the presentation they would identify as the strongest one. Like, well, some of the students decided to conduct an interview. Fine, very good. Some of the students decided to design a movie maker presentation and then just to present it on screen with their feedback on how they did it. Fine as well. Some of the students just decided to design a poster and present the poster to the rest of the class. Fine as well. So we just provide them with a free hand on how they do it. Well, what we would like, any comments, concerns about it? Questions? Right. What we encourage you to do now, sitting in the groups, you have page 13 in the main part. In the main part. Okay, so there are three samples of main part on each table. Well, it would be great if the topic that you will identify now for further exploration is the topic that you are currently teaching with the students. Although if the topic is imaginary, it's fine. It's great. It's grandiose as well. Well, step one. You will just identify the topic. You agree on the topic in your group. Okay? So just identify the topic. That's step one. Step two, in your group, you will try to identify the concept, the big idea that you would like the students to further explore. Like, for instance, in my example here, a good life. Because we came up with the question, what are the attributes of, why are some attributes of a good life universal? We would say that our concept is attributes of a good life, right? So this is our concept. Well, you identify this concept, the thing that the students will be constantly reviewing. Then step three, you will agree on the activities. You will just provide a list of activities, right? That you would like the students to explore. If you use this example, fine as well. Well, absolutely. And step four, in your group, you will try to identify the final product, what the students will do as the outcome. Unfortunately, we don't have much time. That's why we would highly appreciate if you work very quickly. Or we may proceed it after the break.
No, but we have 5 minutes.
Okay, we now have 5 minutes, so you may come up with step one and step two. And then we will proceed, okay? So, and this is a group work. Please raise the hands if something is not clear to you or you want some clarification. So you just identify the topic. You will say that, that the topic with, that, that we are exploring is, for instance, sports in our life, right? Then you will identify the concept, the big idea that, that you will always returning to. And if you also identify the guiding question, that's fine. Then activities, the tasks that you will give the students, and the final product, sort of your presentation, student presentation.
Dear colleagues, I'd like to present your attention one example of project work which has been made by the teachers of English language in our school. So if to speak about the projects, I would like to talk on the types of the projects. So the projects can be role plays, research projects, creative projects, mono projects, and interdisciplinary. Raise your hands those who heard my presentation on the August conference. Okay, so during this conference I spoke about an interdisciplinary project during August. So all of them have been characterized by the presence of objectives. The expected results of the project should have practical meaning. It means that they should use this in their real life. The students study by themselves. And the contents of the project should be thoroughly structured. And of course, methods of research work should be used. So now we can come to the definition of the project. So what is a project? Is it a plan?
No, not a
work. Is it a work? Yes, to some extent. It is a part of the work. But it should be thoroughly organized. It should be thought over, and we should reach a certain aim, or we should obtain our achieve objectives, and also it should contain a plan. So it had been taken from RWCT dictionary made by Musitova, because according to our policy, I had to make references. Where did I take it from? So pretend that it is not October, it is September. Your students came to school. What do you ask them? In September. How are you holiday? How did you spend your summer? So we are all of us English teachers, and we ask the same question. And we ask them, what did you do during holidays? We went somewhere, some of them were not in Kazakhstan. And we decided, in our group, our team of English teachers, decided to concentrate our attention on three main summer events. Can you name them?
What happened during the summer?
Camping.
Summer
2008.
Okay, I'll prompt you. July, the beginning of July, Astana.
The birthday of Astana. The birthday of Astana.
Yes, the anniversary of Astana. So grade 6 and 7 worked on this project because not all the students were in Astana in July. Then, the second event,
Olympic
the Games of August 2008.
Olympic Games,
right one. So, grades 8 and 9 worked with the project Olympics. And a very sad event, awful event.
The end of the
war. Yes, right one. War in Ossetia, right one. This was the breaking finish or the breaking ending of the summer. And that is why more serious students, grade 10 students, were involved in this project, War in a City. So, I would like to give word to Mr. Anatoly, because he will tell what did you start with, what instruction did you give students to, and how did we organize our first work with this project?
Well, actually, I just make a reference to your main part, pages. Five and six. Well, getting the students involved, getting the grade 10 students involved in this project, we did not focus their attention on who, or we actually discouraged them of pronouncing, of providing their opinion on who was right and who was wrong. On the contrary, we tried to concentrate to develop their critical thinking and to guide them to understanding that each war, any war, is bad for ordinary people. Well, we just used Osisha as an example of this. At the beginning, we brainstormed the political parties, the personalities, politicians who were involved in the conflicts, their aims, their objectives, what they planned to obtain. But this led the students eventually to understanding that a war is bad for ordinary people through the guiding question that we encourage them to explore. What our responsibility is for maintaining the situation in peace. So that's how we started our project. We just brainstormed these ideas. We just collected ideas from the students, and then we came up with that kind of question.
Okay. So then the students were given the choice to present the information. They had to prepare a slideshow in PowerPoint program. They had to prepare a poster, maybe you have seen them in our atrium. And one group of students had chosen to make a booklet. Unfortunately, I have only one paper, and that is why I will give it to you. Just pass it, okay? So, a booklet, a poster, or a slideshow. So it is very good because students choose by themselves what to do, what will be the result of their work. And before this, the students were given a very thorough instruction, guiding instruction, what to do. And Miss Elizabeth will tell about this.
Before Miss Elizabeth will start her speech, I would like to add that the students were very free in their choice to organize a group. So usually we use different methods to organize the groups, right? So maybe you will be able. Today we use a technique when we put different papers into a file, so we organized the groups without your wish to work together. And at this activity, the students had an opportunity just to pick up the partner, to choose the partner, because not all of them were interested to make a booklet, to create a booklet. Another were interested just to create a movie maker and so on. And it's a very good aspect of this work. Yes, Elizabeth, sorry.
Okay, one very important thing about this project is that we learned a lot. We as teachers learn from the students, and the students learn from us too. And one thing that I learned is that my perceptions or my ideas of the war were heavily influenced by CNN and the Western media. And Anatoly pointed out to me that the students were similarly heavily influenced by Russian media. So you see, we came into this project with different perceptions. But through the thoughtful guiding questions provided by Anatoly during the brainstorming session, we all came to a mutual understanding that actually conflict is conflict, and pointing fingers doesn't help. The important thing is for us to maintain peace. On your tables you have the documents prepared, the main part, the one called main part, and I'd like you to turn to pages 5 and 6 of that document. And over there you have an example of the task sheet that we provided students with. As my colleagues have mentioned, it is important to provide students with clear instructions. Because without clear instructions, they would not be able to work effectively on projects. So as you can see on the documents that you've been provided with, on the task sheet we start by providing students with a theme. And in this case, our theme was the terrible effects of war.
Any war.
Yes.
Based on the war decision.
The terrible effects of war. And then, in quotes, a focus on the war in Ossetia. So this was just an example of the war. And the project was provided by grade 10 English teachers, Anatoly, Adema, and myself. And we gave the students a duration of 1 week to work on this project, September the 2nd to the 5th. That was the first week of the school year. So we provided them with a task summary. They were asked to work in pairs on this theme, to conduct their research and to create slideshows or posters to support their presentations to an audience, which would comprise of teachers and their classmates. We provided them with objectives, and it is important to have objectives, because if students do not have objectives, they do not know what they are trying to achieve. In this case, We expected them to be able to select and analyze information obtained from books, from the internet, and any other sources. They were expected to use their time productively. We gave them 5 days, and we expected them to finish their work within this time frame. They were supposed to organize their work effectively, to work independently as individuals and collaboratively with their partners. We wanted them to show a thorough understanding of the areas of interaction, which Anatoly introduced to you briefly at the beginning of this session. And they were expected to inform their peers because they were going to present their projects to the people in their classroom, okay? Apart from that, they were expected to exercise their creativity, to approach this activity with creativity and originality, and to apply knowledge and skills obtained from other subject areas, such as knowledge obtained from their ICT lessons and creating slideshows and things like that, or knowledge obtained from their history lessons regarding war, that kind of thing. So we expected them to use their skills and knowledges from other subject areas. And finally, they were supposed to produce these posters and slideshows and to present them to their classmates, demonstrating their understanding of the themes. And we provided them with our plan for assessment, okay? Because when you have a project, you have to assess it. And they have to know how you are going to assess this project. We gave them some key questions. Okay, we gave them some key questions that were meant to guide their work on these projects. And here are the questions. How can you learn to live in peace with yourself and with others? What helps people to live in peace and agreement? What forms of interactions are the most effective in the international community? How can we understand ourselves and others better? What values and treasures unite us? And what are the terrible effects of war? What can you do as an individual to help war victims? So these questions were provided to help them to think as they worked on their final product, in this case, posters, slideshows, and booklets. So we gave them a timeline. 70 minutes to research on the internet and to get an understanding of the theme, to look for pictures and other supporting material, and to prepare drafts of their presentation. And then, for homework, they're expected to finalize their drafts because we cannot do everything in class. The time, of course, is not enough. And then 80 minutes in class to prepare the final samples of their work. And then, finally, they were expected to make a classroom presentation. So this was the timeline. Finally, we presented them with questions for reflection. And they're supposed to reflect at the end of the project. How is your project connected to the areas of interaction? Did you engage yourself fully in this task? What would you do differently next time? And how can you as an individual contribute to the promotion of global peace and understanding? We gave them a rubric, the assessment tool that we were going to use to assess them. And I think you have a copy of this rubric.
Yes.
You have a copy of this rubric.
On page 6.
On page 6 of the main part. So we gave them a rubric that we were going to use to assess their work. And this rubric had 3 levels of achievement. Very simple, A, B, and C. The highest level of achievement being A, and the lowest being C. And we were assessing basically 2 things, the personal engagement, how they engaged in the task. And finally, the outcome. And the outcome is what we saw at the end, what they presented us with, the slideshow or the poster. Regarding the personal engagement, they were supposed to manage their time well, as well as their resources, to select appropriate information and to reflect. If they did it very well, they got an A. If they did it very poorly, they got a C. Regarding the final outcome, we were concerned with the quality of the product they presented. We expected their posters to be researched, to have good information, to be relevant to the theme, to be logical, attractive, and to be written in grammatically correct English in as far as possible. Of course, we understand that mistakes, are inevitable, okay? But we expect them to try to do their best. To handwrite their posters, which means we did not want them to just print stuff off the internet and then paste them on a paper and say, here's my poster. They were supposed to analyze the information, select, and write some information on their posters. And then we expected it to be interesting and well organized. And finally, during the
Rubrics.
what is it, how to use it, how to create Rubik, and who can create a Rubik. Now we are going to speak about it and do some activities. So we need eight volunteers.
Well, we will just brief you about what criterion referenced assessment is about. Although it is a very, very difficult terminology, you know. Generally, the idea behind it is quite obvious and hopefully quite understandable. So we just need eight volunteers. Four volunteers will be students.
Yeah.
Four volunteers will be teachers.
Who wants to be a student?
Otherwise, we will have encouraged volunteers.
Very brave person.
Yes, please.
How active this table,
good.
This
excellent.
Group. Very nice.
Teachers, please.
Two more. No teachers. Everybody is a student.
Everybody wants to be a student,
right,
which is great.
I need a student. I will invite you. And another student. Nothing difficult. It's just fun.
Yes, yes. So how many students do we have?
Lucy,
oh, teacher, okay. Good. Teacher. I'm your student. Although I don't have this paid. Two more teachers. You are teachers of English, right?
Oh, number one. Great.
Great.
Oh my gosh! So, let's clap
for
this.
Thank you very much. Yes.
They are great.
Yes,
great.
One more teacher.
Students are great. Teachers are great as well. One more teacher, please.
Maybe need a volunteer.
Yeah. Usually we do like this. The youngest.
Okay.
Encourage volunteers.
Yeah.
Okay. So what we would like the teachers to do now is, you will just occupy the places over there on gray chairs, okay? You will just be sitting there at that table. Please go there.
But you need a pen.
Oh, yeah, you just need a pen. A pen which is P-E-N, not a P-A-N. Well, for some of the students, we do need a pen, right? Which is P-A-N.
Yeah.
But not for these students.
So,
Four.
You follow me.
You'll just leave the room. Okay. So, what we do now is, we have student one who is very kindly asked to stay here on my place. Right. So, we have the team of teachers, right? The team of teachers now will individually assess the student's performance.
Mm.
Is that clear? Okay. So, your task is just to applaud. Applaud. Okay. Thank you very much. That was the brilliant performance by student one. The task, well, applause to student one. Good. Now, teachers, you will just evaluate his performance using whatever scale you like. Using an ordinary scale. Just put him a mark, okay, for his applause. And you may take a seat. Thank you very much. You may return your place. That's it. So, yes, an excellent student. Well, you will just evaluate his performance, putting any mark that you think he deserves. Right. Well, student three, you may occupy your place as well. We will call you a bit later. Yes, please occupy your place. And thank you very much for participating in this. Now, okay, so as team of teachers and as team of supporters to the teachers, we now will try to identify our objectives. So what do we want to see in the procedure of producing applauses, right? So what would we like to see? How would we assess the applauses? So, What exactly will be included in this procedure, okay? So what do we expect the other students to do? Sorry? Okay. So he should encourage the audience to follow suit, right? To do the same. Very good, okay. So it is Let me call it inspiration, okay? Inspiration.
Inspire
other students. Yes, with given enthusiasm. Very good.
Inspire the audience.
Inspire the audience, thank you.
Inspire
the audience. Thank you very much, student three. Inspire the audience. It's great that student is also included in the process. So what else do we want to see? Well, I feel that it could be, you know, the length. The length, okay?
How strong they
were. Oh, well.
How strong they
were. So, these are our gods, and of course, well, I can't help including this. So, how
length
and strength, okay. Length and strength.
With a loud, maybe, quiet, loud, audible.
Audible, right? Audibility. Whether all the people here, all the people here, is able to hear it, right? So audibility. Is it the word?
Yeah.
Audibility, right? Audibility. Everyone hears, right? Well, an important thing here is that we identify this as expectations, but these expectations become our dimensions. Dimensions are the things that we would like to see, okay? We would like the students to perform during the actual presentation. Well, accordingly, we may identify the levels of the students' participation. Well, this we call dimensions. These are actually expectations, right? Well, and obviously, a student may perform differently, in a different way, right? Then, it would be great if a student is provided with these levels beforehand, before he or she begins this activity. Now, again, this could be very, very simple, like low, average, and out of this world, high. Well, and it's actually up to the teacher where he begins the definitions, right? Because this, what we are going to write here, will be our descriptors. Something that describes the performance, right? Well, on the high level, inspire the audience. Well, it could be something, or you may help me here. If it is a high level of inspiration, that what performance could that be? Everybody, right? Everybody. Well, everybody applauses with that student. Yeah, thank you. Everybody is excited. Is excited. And? Applauses with the participant, right?
And involved.
Involved, okay. Involved. Right. Now, so it means that everybody will clap, right? Is that good? Okay, so average.
Some, not all of them applause.
Half of the audience.
Yes.
Half of the audience.
Maybe 60 or 70%.
Okay. We will just count, right? Half of the audience. Half of the audience is excited, right? Excited. And involved, right? Well, and low level will be, of course,
not smiling.
Or very few people, right? Very few people. Very few people are excited. Right, now, for the length and strength, could be, well, 10 seconds or more, right? Exceeding the 10 second limit. Okay, exceeding 10 seconds, which means that a student is clapping for more than 10 seconds, right? And what about the strength? And he claps or she claps, how?
Yes.
enthusiastically. Exceeding 10 seconds with enthusiasm. Enthusiasm. Devotion. Right, now average level here for length and strength will be from, let's say, 5 to 9 seconds, right? 5 to 9 seconds.
Some.
With, yes, thank you, with some enthusiasm. With some enthusiasm. All right, and here, well, less than 5 seconds, obviously. Less than 5 seconds. No enthusiasm. At all. No. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay. Well, now audibility. Everybody hears clearly, right? Everyone hears clearly. Now, only two tables hear clearly, right? Only two tables here. Well, and low level will be only the first tables here, right? Only the first. The first row hears clearly. Hears clearly. Okay. Right. So, do you agree with all these definitions? Fine, great. So, this is what we call the rubric. Now, let's call participant 2. Lucy, where are you? Good. So this is our student 2, and this is our student 4. Student 4, please occupy a place. We will just call you later. Please sit. Okay. Now, student 2, you just study this rubric, okay? You will just study these expectations because your idea now is to perform with inspiration, to preserve the length of your clapping, right? And to be audible so that everybody hears you. Your task is to clap, okay? So that everybody is excited and involved. Everybody would also like to clap with you. Now, you will clap for more than 10 seconds, or at least 10 seconds, and that everybody hears you quite clearly. So we will ask the back table whether they heard you clearly or not. So you will occupy this place. You will stand here, please. Okay. Now, this is student 2, okay? Well, teachers, you are all ears now, right?
Yeah.
Good. Okay, so, just before.
Clap
here.
No, only a student.
A student only.
Not the audience.
Well, but look, she needs to inspire the audience. If the audience claps back, then it's a great inspiration. Okay, so.
From the beginning.
Again.
Clap.
Begin.
Is that it? Great. Okay, please take your seat. Now, teachers, you will evaluate her performance. Please take your seat.
Thank you very much.
Okay, well, and each teacher individually, using this rubric, right? And each teacher individually just provide her opinion about it. Okay, so let's begin with the first teacher.
Very briefly.
Briefly.
About the first student.
Well,
and about the...
No, about the second one.
I'll give to her the bad math because the audience didn't clap with her and not everybody in the end of the desk listened to her because she don't speak and then everybody other people don't listen to her claps because they was very passive, yeah. And only. And
not very
the
long.
Next.
Yes,
yes.
Not very long.
Yes,
not very long, was
it
very short, yeah. And that's all. I think I'll give her back my.
Excellent. For all the levels, for all the dimensions, right? Inspiration, length, and audibility.
Yeah.
Okay, well, where's this? Sorry. Well, no. The second teacher, please take your seat for a while, okay?
I think that her mic is very low because we didn't hear her. It was so short and without any expression, without any emotions.
So, do you give a low mark for all the dimensions?
No, I think inspire the audience is average.
Average, okay. So, average, low and low, right?
Low.
Very good. The next teacher.
My opinion is the same.
So, average, low and low, right?
Low and low.
Great. Thank you. The fourth teacher, very good.
I'm almost the same opinion, low and low.
Uh-huh.
She couldn't motivate the audience to clap with her. And also it was very short.
Right.
And not so loud.
Uh-huh. Very good. Okay, thank you very much. Now, we would really love to hear the teacher's opinion about the first participant. So let's return to the first participant. Which mark did you give? Did you give
without
her?
Comments?
Without comments, just your mark. Remember that.
About
the first mark.
Four.
Okay.
Three.
Excellent.
Very good.
Okay.
Now is the third student turn.
Now it's turn for the third student. You stay here, right? Good. So you know the expectations, right? You were here in the audience, and you were even involved in designing the rubric. But great, okay. The mark, which means that you work in a group and you put just one mark, okay? So you'll just come up with one mark in all the three dimensions. You will agree on one mark, which means that you will explore the dimension inspiration, and you will come up with a level, agreed level, like you would say that it's high, for instance, and you agree on it. The length and strength, the same procedure, and the audibility. So I don't think you will need much time, but anyway, please work here.
Just discuss
it.
Okay, we discuss about her, and we want to take her excellent mark because everybody clapped with her, and she was very emotional. It was very emotional, and has a good experience of everybody excited and involved with her, and exciting 10 sections with exhalations, yeah, and everyone heard clearly because it was very loudly her claps.
Okay, so you come with an agreed decision, and everybody agrees with you, right? Gunnar deserves high level.
Very high level.
Very
yeah.
Good. Thank you very much.
Congratulations,
Gunnar. Okay, now the fourth student. You know the criteria, right? You know, you understand them. Good. Well, but your task is, first of all, to follow all this and to be creative. To express your creativity and personality in clapping. Okay? Using all this, following all this, but in addition, you will also do it creatively. Yes, creatively. Творчески, that's creatively. Well, something that really underlines your personality. Come here.
Just
Excellent. Thank you. Thank you, Lucy. Miss Lucy, while they are discussing the creativity, right, and coming up with their final decision about creativity, can we please show your clapping? Because I really love that moment.
Okay.
Okay. And you discuss, right? You discuss the creativity
of
the posture.
You are very busy.
Yeah. You're busy.
So.
I'm sorry.
When we try,
just
not only
yes,
like
yes.
This way, I'm not sure
sorry.
That I will be perfect like before.
Well, I really enjoyed it. Thank you very much. And thank you for doing this special.
And we think that this activity, this game, it's very helpful for you. It will be useful in your work, and you enjoy and just have a little fun here from our very, very busy work, because you're really, really busy today.
Now, in order to justify your mark for the creativity of the fourth student.
Okay. She couldn't create, creative clapping,
uh-huh.
And she couldn't express her own personality by
right.
clapping.
Right.
That's why we put her good.
Uh-huh. Okay. Very good, thank you. Okay. Excellent. Well, now let's clap very strongly to the team of students and to the team of teachers who have done an excellent job here. Subject-specific assessment in language B, in English, okay? Because, well, we do have very specific assessment criteria, and Adela will tell you about it.
Okay, so now we'll speak about the assessment within MYP program, within RB recommendations. And if to speak about this, I want to stop on the first student. So did he knew all this? Had he, why his mark was low?
Because he didn't know
the expectation. Because he didn't see this. And why was these girls, Brunara, right? Why was Brunara's mark highest?
Because she knows about.
Because she knew all the expectation. The same is with us, with the teachers and with the students. When we say, so I can't definitely answer this question. Can you justify the marks that you give your students before coming to this school? Before getting acquainted with the criterion referenced approach. I didn't know about this. But I have heard about this once, when as a young teacher, like most of you, I worked in a city, it was called Kazakh Classical Lyceum in Petropavlovsk, in the north of Kazakhstan. And to defend my work, I was given the following slide, please, criterion, let us say so. It was 10 years ago. So I have to defend, as I said, my work. And I could reach the first level, the first criterion, if my work had been done completely, and if the structure was correct, and if the professor had no remarks to my work. Then, the middle level, let us say so, if the work is done completely, but the structure is not correct, and she had some remarks to my work, then the lowest level I could get if the half of the work had been done, and the structure was not defined. And if the fourth part of the work is done and there is no structure at all, I could get the lowest level. So you see, I don't remember my mark, but still I remember this criteria when I first acquainted with that. So, how do we usually assess children in ordinary schools? We compare the students. I know, I'm too emotional person, and sometimes I can give 5 to the student who usually studies with a satisfactory mark if he learns the dialogue by heart and come just to encourage him. You know? but I'm not followed by any criteria. I want the students next time to prepare this dialogue, to extend his work, to improve his learning, to love English as a subject. So, but it is not just, as it is said in the world's practice. Because normal approach to the general assessment is based on the comparing students' achievements with the norm or with the majority of the students' answers. But criterion reference approach is based on the comparisons of the students' answers with the special pattern or example. And it is becoming more and more popular recently because we are using it in Miraset every day now, but you will be using it maybe in some 2 or 3 years or some schools are already using it, right? So, okay, next, what are we doing? What are we doing during our English lessons? You saw in your papers 4 mega skills. Can you name them?
Reading,
writing, speaking, and listening. So these are 4 main mega skills. And 5 criteria, A, B, C, and D, are based on these 4 mega skills. What are they? Why are these letters? And we shall define them. So, I took only one example with oral communication. So if we speak about criterion A, we speak about message and interaction. How a student can organize his speech. How he can present the information. How can he understand and answer the questions and statements. How can he respond or answer the teacher's questions. And his ability to support a dialogue is also assessed here. Then criterion B, it is also oral communication criterion, but we check here grammar, vocabulary, and spelling, intonation, oral presentation, right? Next 2 criteria are writing criteria, C and D. Again, criterion C. When we check, do you remember, you write a composition in Russian language. So you follow the structure. It should be the introduction, the body or the main idea, the main part, and the conclusion. So if the student follows all this, he gets maximum level in criterion C. But if he makes mistakes, grammar, spelling, so then he will not be criterion D, yet maximum level. Do you understand? Okay. And the last criterion, it is reading comprehension, criterion E. Here we check students' ability to understand, to analyze the text, again to support basic ideas, to extend his ideas, and to provide some details. So for each criterion we have special table like this. And this table has 2 parts, quantitative and qualitative contents, let us say so. So achievement level 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, they are the highest. And there is a descriptor, and it is the quantitative contents. Let us say so, качественное содержание. And achievement level, количественное содержание. Okay, so here you see, if the student does not reach a standard described by any of the descriptors given below, he gets 0. If his answer is, he has some difficulty in communication, and he sometimes is irrelevant or repetitive, or some opinions are unsupported, he reaches level 3 or 4. And if he has the best answer, he reaches the level 7 and 8. Okay, all the students in our school, you have it in your main part.
Page 12.
So, every student has this table. What table is it? So, practically, you see all the criteria, all the 5 main criteria, A, B, criteria, A, B, C, and D. And vertically, you have the quantity part, the levels of achievement. And each student, before doing some task, he has this table in front of him, and he knows what level can he reach or he can achieve. You can see it, or you can take it with you also. So, and if we speak about rubrics, they are assessment tools. creating rubrics were made by Mr. Anatoly and Ms. Lucy, because you did.
By the students and by the teachers.
Oh, sorry, by the students
and, got them involved.
And by the teachers, by you, of course. I think that our smart, the only man here, could have reached the best results if he knew all the dimensions, right? Do you agree with me?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so, and creating rubrics. First of all, the process of creating rubrics should include the following steps. So you, this is highly recommended. First of all, you observe the aims and objectives of the topic. So you have your plan, your curriculum. Then you should observe the contents of the assessment criteria, I mean this page. Then you should highlight the necessary aspect. If it is a dialogue, you pay attention to what? To the intonation, right? If it is a written task, what do you pay attention to? To grammar, to structure, right? Thank you. So, then you create these rubrics of assessments, and the tasks for the students should give them the opportunity to choose the levels corresponding all the levels of each criteria. So, now, let us work together and tell me, please, help me to identify the tasks for each criteria. So, if it is oral communication, what task should be? Monologue, dialogue, discussion, criteria, what else? Story speaking task, project, presentation, oral presentation, right? Written task, criterion C and D. What tasks can we create then?
Writing a composition.
Writing an essay.
Report.
Letter writing. Different kinds of letter writing. Letter of complaint. Introductory letter. And so on and so forth. Then, add criterion E. Okay, different kinds of texts, advertisements, newspaper articles,
reading.
Magazine articles, some literacy works, right?
Right.
So, you have already seen the task for assessment. They should include the description of the task, the instructions or the recommendations for the students, list of criteria according to each, because when we gave the task to the student to present the poster or the dialogue or the slideshow, we gave them, you will be assessed according to criteria, oral presentation A and B. Then, and of course you provide the students with rubrics for assessment. And the highest level or the best results can be achieved when you create these rubrics together with the students. So it is so-called высший пилотаж in Russian, I say. If you create such rubrics together with the students, for example, you say we will work with the project A Good Life, right?
Absolutely.
Then let us create rubric. What should the best presentation or what should the best result? What? How can you see? How can you judge? Yes, this work. And the students help you to create this, and they take part in it, and very actively.
Yeah,
so this is
so
the highest level. Okay. So, and when you work with assessment tasks, so teacher should, first of all, if it is not clear, we have some students that do not understand some of the aspects. And of course, the teacher should comment on the aims and the contents. The teacher should give short recommendations how to make the work. The teacher should involve all the students in the discussion task. And while draft writing or work creating, also the teacher should follow and stand by the student. And of course, next step, Ms. Elizabeth will speak about it, reflection. And the teacher should assess not only the student's work, but also his own work. What I did wrong. Because we are not always right. We do make mistakes sometimes. So, and I would like to stop on the advantages of the criterion referenced approach. So, these criteria are known, accepted, and followed by all the participant educational process. The teacher knows what he wants, right? The student knows what to do. Okay, and sometimes maybe parents know because they have, our parents have all these rubrics, they have all these criteria and they know how his student studies. Then it helps to create the situation of success and self-confidence. And if you have these criteria, I'm repeating, in front, you are being guided by the aims and the objectives. Each student precisely defines what must he do. Then here we follow the differentiated approach to each student. If I, as a student, know that I can't reach level 7 and 8, but I knew that I know definitely that I can reach level 5 or 6, I will do this work for the level 5 and 6, right? But next time, I'll do my best, I'll try, and I'll reach this level. Is it clear? Okay, thank you. And the student is not under the teacher's total power and control as we used to. You are right, you are not right, because I was up in the Soviet education. Okay, so, and the rules of the game, so practically agree, they are followed, known, and accepted by all the educational process. And I want to finish my part with the basic of the MYP assessment in our school. That the most important aim in MYP assessment is to support and encourage students' learning. You want the students, if you want the student to come to your lesson next time and be very enthusiastic and proceed and extend his learning in English, you will get the best results. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Right, so we would just wrap up with another very important aspect here. The aspect is reflection. Well, we do reflect as teachers, and we encourage the students to reflect on the parts of the process they are involved in, on the final product, and on their participation and on their development as students. Remember the I Belong profile. Right, now, the word is now given to you.
Okay, so today we have been working with the projects, and at the beginning of our workshop this morning, we all came up with some project tasks, right? With guiding questions and looked at assessment, which is very important. You created rubrics. So you give the students a project, you create a tool for assessing them, and they produce their work, and they make their presentations. What next? Is it over? Do you assess them and say, okay, you are excellent, or you are not very good, the project is over? Goodbye? No, that is not what happens. Okay, once you're done with the project, there's something else. You still have some work left. And that brings us to the last part of working with the project, which is reflection. So what is reflection? Reflection is actually what distinguishes human beings from other animals. We have a very special ability to think about our actions, about our experiences, and to come up with decisions based on this. For example, you're a teacher of English, you're in class, it's a Friday, you're tired, and this student comes and says, oh, I've not done my homework. I don't have my homework. You are so angry. So you shout at the student, tell him, you're a very bad boy. Okay, I'm giving you a 3 today. You have a 3, okay? Leave the classroom. Go out, but teacher, no, go. Okay, so you chase the student out of the classroom. You tell him to go and sit outside. And you finish your lesson, you go home at the end of the day. But you know when you're at home and you sit down quietly on your sofa, you're drinking tea, and you remember this student. And you start thinking, wow, did I do the right thing? Okay, you ask yourself some questions. Did I do the right thing? Did I overreact maybe because I was tired? This student is good, he always does his homework. Did I overreact? What are some of the consequences of my actions? Maybe this student will lose interest, not like me, and he will not like my lesson because I embarrassed him and I chased him out of the classroom. Next time, what will I do? How will I react? So this is reflection. And reflection is a very important part of the teaching and learning process. So once you've given your students a project, it is important to provide some time for reflection. We have to go back to the work that we have done, to look at it, and to ask ourselves some useful questions about this. Why is reflection important? Well, there are some reasons. First of all, reflection enables students to make connections between the work that they have done and the objectives. This could be individual objectives or the course objectives. For example, you give students a task, they're supposed to write essays. And you have explained to them that their essays should be well structured. They should have paragraphs. The essay should have an introduction. It should have the main body and it should have a conclusion. And you tell them that your essay should be written using grammatically correct English. So the student has written the essay, you have assessed him, and you said that your work is average. So give your students the opportunity to look at his work and think about it. And he will ask himself some questions such as, did I meet the objectives? Is my work well structured? No, I forgot. My work has no paragraphs. Okay? I've just written, no paragraphs. The grammar is not good. There's no conclusion. So you should give students time to reflect on what they have done. So that is one important objective of reflection, to enable students to connect what they have done to the course objectives. Secondly, through reflection, students can connect what they learned at school to what is happening in the real world. For instance, when we had this project, the war in Ossetia, one of the reflection questions was, what are the terrible effects of war? What can you as an individual do to help victims of war? These kinds of questions. So we're not just concerned with the grammar and the beautiful poster, the nice movie, the interesting movie. You should also allow them time to think about how what they've done in class is related to what is happening in the real world, because the school provides a model of what's happening in the society. And one of the main objectives of teaching students is to prepare them for life in the outside world. So it's very important to always make these kinds of links between what you're teaching and what is happening in real life. And if you do not do this, then you're not helping the students very much. And thirdly, by engaging in reflection, students are able to develop their higher order thinking because they think critically. They analyze their actions, okay? So they're not just reciting information, but they are thinking, how did I write? How did I do this? What can I change? Teachers usually guide student reflection in this space. And it is important for us to understand that reflection occurs throughout the learning process. Like, when you prepare a lesson plan, you should always, as you deliver your lesson, provide students with interesting questions that help them to think about what they're doing, okay? Also, in your introduction, what have you said? Okay, ask the questions as they continue to work to cause them to reflect on what they're doing and on what is happening. So last week we started working on this project. Have you done your research? Or what kind of resources have you consulted? Have you used the internet? Have you used some books? What kinds of books? Have you learned anything new? What about teamwork? Is your partner collaborating with you? So throughout the process, ask them questions. And this is reflection. Questions that enable them to think about what they're doing, to reflect on the process and on the content of what they're learning. There are different kinds of reflection activities, such as journals. You could give your students diaries in which they can reflect. You could ask them to write a reflective essay. You could have them discuss, have discussions in which they reflect on what they've done in class. Through emails, these days students have emails and we have online forums. Those are also some reflective tools that we use. So there are different kinds of reflection tools that we give students. And there's an interesting example over here, because usually we connect reflection to academic activities, as in the classroom. Once you've done a project, you may provide your student with a checklist that enables them to reflect. But in other schools, we may even reflect on behavior. You have a project, and one student does not collaborate well with his partner. During the presentation, he does not participate as he's supposed to. He does not say something. He does not answer questions. Therefore, the final result is not good. So you may ask your student to reflect on their behavior, okay? They can reflect on their behavior. So this is an example of a behavior reflection sheet. What did I do? I did not introduce our group's presentation. Why did I do this? Maybe the student will say, I was not prepared. I did not read the presentation. I was not prepared. What classroom rule did I break? What were my other options? And what effects did my behavior have on my learning and others' learning? Because one student did not participate well, the group result was bad, okay? What will I do next time? So this is an example of a reflection sheet that you can give students. It is not only students that reflect. Teachers also engage in reflection. So it is important for us to reflect on our teaching practices. If you have a lesson plan, you should always leave a little room for reflection at the end of your lesson. And that enables you to save time in planning for the future. And it also makes you mindful about the welfare of your students and the effectiveness of your lesson plan. So ask yourself questions such as, what went well in my lesson? What activities can I use next time? If it doesn't work, do not use it next time, okay? Maybe you think you have an interesting activity, your students do not like it. So reflect and discard what is not useful, keep what is useful. Ask yourself, how can I change this to make it more interesting or more useful next time? The material, did I teach everything? I need to teach them about something. Did I manage to cover all my content? No, why not? Why didn't I teach everything that was on my lesson plan? What happened? Or maybe I was expecting to teach too much in such a short time. And then ask yourself, what are students beginning to understand? And what are they still struggling with? I have tried to teach them, but they don't understand. They're not answering the questions correctly. But they're still not writing well. What went wrong? So we should also reflect. So it is important for students to be given time to reflect on projects and tasks that they're engaging in class. And it's also important for teachers to reflect, okay? So we need to reflect on the teaching process. We need to reflect on our curriculum to ensure that it is effective and appropriate and suitable for the needs of the learners. Thank you.
Well, dear colleagues, we're so much inspired with your enthusiasm and with your support that, well, actually we have to finish here because it's according to the program. But we can't leave it like this without giving you the chance to present your group work. But please try to make it clear and short, okay? So just 1.5 minutes for each table, right? We'll just begin with this table if you don't object, right? So the things that you have done with regard to the project. Unfortunately, we don't have time for creating the rubric, but this is going to be your home assignment, okay? That's your home task for the next lesson. Just to create a rubric with regard to a particular task that you are going to use within the project that you are going to present right now, okay? So let's listen to the first table. You did not mind.
So we hope that we will meet you again.
Yes.
Somehow, and as teachers, we will ask you your home task creating rubric. So now, you have just half a minute to discuss your topic that you created all together in your group, and just give a conclusion, just share your opinion about your topic. Please, uh-huh. 1 minute in the group.
And then we will present for 1 minute, okay?
To that very nice table with pink papers. Please, you. Something.
Yes. Well, that's very creative, okay. That's really good.
So, our topic we have chosen is very common. It is sport in our life. And the question that we have put is, can a person be very successful without going for sport? And this is the question that we have chosen. And you see, we presented our project in the form of a picture, who is the man. You see, he is strong. He is
strong enough.
He is strong enough because he goes in for sport regularly. And we tried to fulfill his parts of the body with the words that connects with the sport. It means the healthy food, all kinds of the sport. It is exercises. It is 8 hours sleep.
that is necessary, and how can sport affect on a good life, and what can help the person with a relationship man. If a person regular goes in for sport, then it goes without saying that he will be better disciplined, better organized, and he will have always, he will be always in a good mood. And if the person he is always in a high spirit, he it will help his work go in further. It will help him to be more energetic, active. You see that it helps his further work. And yes. This is our project, so we think that all the children will be interested in this topic, and they will do a lot of projects in the different way, in the slideshow, in the pictures and the photos, because it is widely spread. And you see in his face broad smile, that means he is very successful. He has a very lucky life. Yes. And I wish you also to be in busy with this, all kinds of this work.
Thank you. So the floor is given to the yellow group. Please. Do you have yellow papers? Right. Very briefly, please.
We choose the same challenge for our project. And first of all, we will write the word traveling, and the pupils will show their expression and what they know about traveling. For example, they will write the words according to this theme. Then we will ask such questions. For example, what country would you like to visit and why? Describe your expressions about the country. Where have you been to? So we will divide our class into groups who had been to had been traveling and who is not travel.
Who is going to travel?
Yeah, who is going to travel? And they will tell their expression about his traveling and about their traveling and their dream traveling. So two groups will discuss by what way they will travel. For example, by car, by plane, and by train. And so I think it is very important and interesting theme for pupils, for students, because they, everybody wants to travel, do some activities, learn other countries, their culture, and they want to be adventurous. And we will help them.
Thank you very much. So we have two yellow groups, one bright and then one is not pale but yellowish. So the floor is to you.
To the yellowish group.
Yellowish. I like it more than
now, just like in the situation of not the students who just imitate the clever ones and repeat the same answer, we repeat the same answer, traveling, yes, our project is traveling. Also, we thought a lot about that, what topic to choose. And at last, eventually, one of the ladies said, well, traveling is okay, so we really travel. And after that, we just shared the ideas where we go from flights, fun, hiking, one of our friends who have experience, visiting countries, have good time. And after that, we started to think about what question we can put to, how to say, to identify the topic or to inspire the students to work about the topic. And after that, here is a list of these questions. What do we know about other countries? And one of the questions was travel, life aim. What's a good travel? Who are you after travel? How do we understand travel? And how do we connect they struggle with our country. So many questions, and after that, well, it was hard work to choose the questions, and eventually I just stopped commanding anything, and ladies chose themselves. They chose this question, how do we understand traveling? It's a quite wide question, and you can you can mean a lot of things under these questions, and you can make students do a lot of things under these questions. With this question, you have to come about the activities. Well, all of the skills that are needed in language, that are readings, that is reading, speaking, writing, and listening, can be developed with this topic. Actually, it's a very deep topic. Let's say, when does the travel happen? For example, first the pen friends might just exchange the letters and postcards to get some knowledge about and information about the countries where they live, where they come from, and after that, well, writing, this is about the writing skill. Reading also, they might just collect the information about the countries as magazine articles or newspaper articles or just internet surfing. After that, you also can include there some exercises with reading and grammar practice. Speaking also, here we can come to the practice of traveling itself. You can going hiking, for example, outside Astana. Actually, there are not so many places outside Astana. Let's say, for example, usually people go to Uchkhoz. You may take students to Uchkhoz, and after, or for example, one day, yes, leaving photos of them, leaving them, show who you are after
hiking there,
So on, yeah, and listening also the same thing. Well, at that time, suddenly, one of our great